just have got to say that a few weeks ago, I was given the privilege of being able to travel the Syracuse area, actually Clay, New York, if you're familiar with the Syracuse area, northwest a little bit of the city. And Edie and I went up and ministered in a church that in 1997, I guess is the year God had me do a few things. Actually started out ministering for that same congregation in the then New York District office where they were meeting as a new church. They'd been there a couple of years. And Pastor Tom Hurtwick back then had invited me to come speak. And on that particular weekend, God moved upon my heart prophetically to preach a message, which was out of Jeremiah, where it says, "You shall not be careful in the year of famine." How many are familiar with that scripture? "You shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water." And I didn't know. I was just being obedient to the Lord back then. But I remember at that altar service, the Spirit of God moved on several hearts, and the word came down, the word of the church, and they were all praying around the altar and seeking God and crying out to God. Well, what God had been speaking to them to do was to move ahead by faith and build their new church. They had property, and that morning God really stirred faith in their hearts. To Him be all the glory. And from that, I was later, as I did back then quite a bit, I travel around and do electrical in the churches. The electrical trade has been my avocation for years. And I actually spent a summer up there working with their volunteers, with their new church, getting to know the people back then. And I would travel home on weekends, and I would always use their volunteers to help drill the holes and pull the wires, and I would show them where to put everything. And they would buy their own materials. On average back then, I could save a church about $40,000 in their electric package from having a contractor do it. And so it was a delight to have them invite Edie and I to come back up and minister a couple weeks ago. And God moved in a powerful way. And it was just a joy. Edie and I's first trip together out with the ministry team. So praise God. And it's something I saw coming and knew that, and Edie saw it too. But I thought it was all going to happen sooner. So those of you that know me, forgive me for waiting on God. Not waiting on God better, I should say. Things are starting to happen, and we thank the Lord for that as God opens new doors to minister. For those that don't know me, I traveled for many years as an evangelist. It's there that I got to know Pastor Joe. He was the evangelist liaison for the Assemblies of God of the district. Having grown up in the Assemblies of God, his father being a pastor, and him traveling as evangelist for many years back then, he was a perfect fit by the Lord to be somebody who would represent the evangelists that were in the district. And I got to know Joe back then very well. I told you before, one of the last times I ministered here, that when I heard that Pastor Joe was coming in to be pastor, it was at the same time God was speaking to me to attend Central Assembly again after several years of not being here. And I just felt the Spirit of God just like do a flip in my heart. It was just such a joy to hear that he was going to be pastor. And from there, God brought me here, and then I met my wife Edie, and all kinds of good things. But anyway, let's turn tonight in our Bibles to John chapter 4. I was asked this morning at 8 o'clock to speak and started praying immediately. But anyway, the Lord began to speak something in my heart. Some part of this had been stirring for a while, but part of it came together for tonight. And we're going to read some scripture here together, and then we're going to ask God's blessing upon His word tonight. In John chapter 4, we're going to skip around a little bit in John chapter 4. For the sake of time, we won't read the whole chapter tonight. The title of tonight's message is, "What Does God the Father Seek?" What does God the Father seek? We hear a lot about us seeking the Lord, us seeking Him. What does He seek? Can you say amen tonight?
Amen.
John chapter 4, verses 9 and 10, "Then says the woman of Samaria to him, How is it that thou, being a Jew, ask drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said to her, If thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that says to thee, Give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water." Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
Verse 13 and 14. Jesus answered and said, "Whosoever drinks of this water shall thirst again, But whosoever drinks of the water that I give him shall never thirst, but the water that I give him shall be into him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. Then down in verses 19 through 23, the woman said to him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and you say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus said to her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, you know not what, we know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. Shall we pray tonight? Father God, take my pitiful efforts and inabilities and transform them tonight into the working tools of the hand of God. Lord, you choose the foolish things of the world to confound those that be wise, the weak things of this world to confound those that be strong, and the things that are not to bring to naught those that are. I surrender myself, as we've sang so well tonight, to be used of you. Bring forth your word and your heart, Holy Spirit, in this hour that we meet together. May our hearts be challenged, may we be drawn closer to you, and may we leave here tonight with a precious gift, a fresh man, even the hidden man of heaven. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. I remember one time years ago ministering a message that was called, God is Chasing You. And we think a lot, again, as I've already said tonight, about us chasing the Lord. That's not where we're going specifically tonight. But how many will testify here tonight that when you got saved, we talk about finding the Lord, but really the Lord found us. Can you say amen? Didn't he? Didn't the Lord find us? I mean to tell you, he came custom tailored right into my life, right where I needed him to be. And he's still doing it today. Can you say amen? Because that's the kind of Father he is. Many of us had difficulties with our fathers growing up, and we have a hard time relating to a loving Father, and we try to understand what that would be like. But I want to tell you, God is all the time modeling not only fatherhood, but, if you can excuse me tonight, motherhood. I recently was in the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota, and I said to the Lord, Lord, you mothered on me out there. Edie couldn't go, and we understood that was not God's will for her to go. I was out there by myself, but I watched God mother me, literally, with his love and take care of me. Send people I didn't even know to take care of me. I had to win for a heart cath on Friday afternoon and win the hospital. I was flying back Saturday afternoon. They're putting all kinds of needles and probes in me and, you know, all this kind of stuff, you know. But the presence of the Lord was so sweet. God, how many know that God knows how to mother us as well as Father? Can you say amen? And he's so good. He's so awesome. But what does he seek tonight? What does God seek? What is there something, could it be possible that the God of the universe that says in Isaiah 40 that all of the nations of the world are like the drop of a bucket to him? That all the inhabitants of the earth are like grasshoppers? That he formed the world in 6 days with his words? The great and mighty God, the great I am, the all-seeing, all-knowing, ever-present God, that he could have a need? Is there anything that God could have a need for? We think no, but the Bible tells us tonight, as we read this powerful story of Jesus meeting a woman at the well, and how that he makes it so clear, but the hour comes, and now is when true worshipers shall worship me in worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. We're going to talk about that tonight, how the Father seeks people to worship him in spirit and in truth. Can you say amen? Amen. He knows us. The very hairs of our head are numbered. Each one has a number. Can you say amen? And all of our tears are in a bottle. I remember a time, I probably shared this with you before, but I remember a time in my life where I was having a pity party. How many of you have ever had a pity party?
Right.
You're the only one invited. You don't want anybody else there. Nobody can add any comments. You just tell them, shut up and leave you alone. You're going to sit there and feel sorry for yourself for a while. And I was in that place in my life. And I began to think about the fact that the Lord had said that we're more valuable than many sparrows. Now I'm a Pennsylvania country boy from down just south of here in Bradford County. Grew up in a farming community. My first job was working for a chicken farm. I worked haying it in the summertime. 63 kids in my graduating class, very small school in East Smithfield, Pennsylvania. That's my background. And I don't want to grieve anybody tonight, but we used to shoot sparrows with a BB gun. Sparrows were not very valuable to us as boys. girls is a big deal. It just doesn't click in my understanding. You know what I'm saying? I remember at that time in my life and saying to the Lord, Lord, what? I know you died for the whole world. And I know it's said that if I was the only one, or one of you were the only one, that you would have died for us, yet nowhere is that in the Bible. It's sort of speculation, understanding the love of God and for what he is, and you would have done that, I'm sure. But what personalizes it for me? And I remember in a prayer place, how many of you have learned to love to pray tonight? Prayer starts out as a discipline. It turns into desire and it becomes delight. Can you say amen?
Yes.
And men, don't let the women do all the praying. Can you say amen tonight? Amen. God help me to address the men several times tonight on the subject of prayer. Because God wants us to pray and to hear his voice and to seek his face. Jeremiah 33:3 says, call unto the Lord and he'll show you great and mighty things that you know not. How many of you have ever been in the presence of God and in prayer and God just blew you away with some revelation, some understanding, something that wasn't there before? I said to Pastor Joe last week, I said, you know what, that was an awesome truth what you brought out on Wednesday night. You talked about what made love hate. He said, you know, I was standing here in the middle of ministering that, and that came to me right then. I said, isn't God good? That he just brings those revelations. Well, in that place in my life, I was feeling sorry for myself, and I was crying out to the Lord. All of a sudden, I had a vision. Must have been a young man then. You say amen. But I had a vision. And in this vision, I saw this finger, and it was starting to, this was a long ago, Ricky Paul was probably working for me back then. But anyway, it was a long time ago. That's a little story that I'm going to do it tonight. Right? Oh, my God. But I saw this finger writing something in this vision. And this finger was writing something. I saw the color red. And I saw him write N-O-L. And I realized it was writing my name. And then I realized as I seen that vision that the Lord was writing my name in blood. And then the scripture came to my mind. Don't rejoice that the demons are subject to you, but rejoice that your names are written in the Lamb's book of life. Can you say amen tonight? Your name is written as you're a born-again believer in the Lamb's book of life. God loves you tonight. Can you say amen? In the creator of the universe have a need in the garden in Genesis chapter 2. And I'm going to read just a couple of scriptures here because I want us to see something. This came to me just so fresh today, right from the Lord as I was working. And how many know you don't always have to be on your knees to hear from God? It just helps. Amen.
Yes.
But you can be working and God can speak to you. But in Genesis chapter 2, 21 through 25, it says, the Lord caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he woman and brought her to the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and mother and shall cleave to his wife, and they shall be one flesh. They're both naked, the man and his wife, and they were not ashamed. You know, God in the Garden of Eden had a plan. Most of us just read over and we just don't understand what things could have been because we understand how things turned out. Can you say amen?
Yeah.
But how many of you know that the Father just loved spending time with Adam and Eve every day, all day, back then?
Right. Yeah.
If you just got to know God to know that, can you say amen? You just got to know who he is. You got to understand it's in harmony with the scriptures, that the Father God just loved that. And the Bible says in one place that he created, in 1:29-31, it shows the finishing of the heaven and earth and that they were one back then. When God created the heavens and the earth, they were one. It was all one, and he was there, and he walked with man and with woman in the cool of the garden. And God the Father loved that. That's what God's greatest and most perfect plan is. That's why he's got heaven waiting for us on the other side. Can you say amen? Because he's going to have that again with us. Can you say amen? Because he so longs for that. He so longs for us to be in his presence. He so longs for us to walk with him. He so longs for us to spend time with him. God understands it's not just that we got to do it. It's that he wants us to do it because he wants us to be one with him. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And in the Garden of Eden, that's the way it was in the beginning. God never left. And you never left God. And they walked with him. They talked with him. And they were with him all the time in the beginning, in that beautiful place in the garden. He didn't have to go pray. He was right there. You say amen? He was there. And then we know the tragic story of what happened. And then they sinned, and we know the curse in that story. We won't go into the whole thing tonight. Read it again in your private devotional if you get a chance, and let God speak to you through it. But you have to understand that that's God's perfect will for mankind. It's fellowship with Him. Can you say amen? He just loves to spend time with us. He loves it when we spend time with Him. Can you say amen?
Yes.
And there's no better place that you can be than to be walking and talking with the Lord and spending time in His wonderful presence. And then we know what happened. Sin came in chapter 3, verse 24. So he drove out the man and placed the east of the Garden of Eden cherubim and a flaming sword which turned every way to keep and protect the way of the tree of life. All of a sudden, the spiritual realm and the natural realm were separated by sin. How many of you know the spiritual realm and the natural realm can be still and will be still separated by sin today?
Right.
I was thinking as I was coming here tonight, maybe we just open up the service tonight. Just all of us, because we're human and we live in a fallen world, just need to take a bath in the blood of Jesus. How many of you try to do that every day? Just go before the Lord and get under the blood. I do that every morning when I rise up to pray. I just get under the blood of Jesus and I ask God to search my heart and ask Him to show me anything in my life that's displeasing to Him. Ask Him to forgive sins that I have done, both known and unknown. Can you say amen?
Amen.
But in the garden, that's what separated. That cut some of you having a hard time praying through right now. Maybe there's not enough taught, not in this church, but maybe because we listen to so much radio, watch so much Christian television, we got this potpourri, this mishmash of all this doctrine and all this truth. We just kind of got all this lovey-dovey, fluffy doctrine out there that doesn't teach us that it's so important to go to the Father and ask Him to forgive us for our sins. Maybe there's not enough repentance in today's teaching, and you've forgotten that sometimes you just got to go get a bath. Can you say amen? Sometimes you got to go and let the eyes of the Lord examine your heart. Sometimes we have to seek Him and say, God, show me and seek me and see if there's any wicked way found in me. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Sometimes we have to do that. Brother John brought some of that out in tonight's prayer and worship. It's a perfect prayer. Don't let anybody convince you don't have to keep repenting. You can say amen as a Christian, but God will just fill you with the power of His Spirit. Can you say amen? He'll reassure you. And once again, the heaven will be open to you. Once again, the garden and His presence will be open to you. Once again, you'll be able to walk in the fullness of His Spirit. If you'll just understand that in the garden, there was perfect communion between the Father, and He loved it. He loves it. The Father seeks. He seeks such a person and such people to fellowship with Him. You know, tonight there's something that I call sweet rebellion. We're living in a day, I don't know how many people realize it, but things are introduced in this world through comedy. What I mean is that, well, as fun as watching TV is and having a laugh from time to time, that there's a lot of things that have been introduced into the world, into the church, into society, and they've used comedy to do it. Things we wouldn't accept 30 years ago, we accept today because we've laughed about it. We've learned to laugh about it. How many remember the Munsters and the Bewitched and the shows that made us laugh about witchcraft? And I'm not trying to paint something black that isn't black, and it doesn't have to be black. If it leads you to black, then it's wrong. Can you say amen?
Right.
But we as a nation learned to laugh, and we learned to laugh about things. We've laughed about the homosexual agenda to the point where we think it's funny. Have that break your heart into a million pieces, you won't think it's funny anymore. But we've learned to laugh about things. We've learned, now we're laughing about adultery. We can't watch a show on TV, it doesn't have an adulterous affair on it. We laugh about fornication. We've learned to laugh. It's sad that we've learned to laugh about things. Can you say amen? When God's heart is broken, can you say amen?
Amen.
There's something I call sweet rebellion. We even learn to laugh about rebellion. Well, I'm a little rebel. God forgive us. Can you say amen?
Amen.
in 1 Samuel 15:22-23, and Samuel says, "Is the Lord great delight in burnt offering and sacrifices, obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and hearken than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected you from being king." Talking, as we know, to King Saul through the prophet Samuel back then. I one time studied witchcraft. I had a reason to that I won't go into tonight. I really felt I was trying to help somebody. But do you know that in black witchcraft, in the original black witchcraft, which is very satanic, that in black witchcraft, such things used to be practices. In order to be a black witch, you had to be baptized in water that a newborn baby had been drowned in. It's such a mockery of anything that's holy unto God. Do you understand human sacrifices that take place and animal sacrifices in the name of witchcraft? Well, we've just learned to laugh about it. We think it's cute or funny, and we. But, you know, there's something called what I call sweet rebellion. And in the sweet rebellion, there's nothing black about it. I mean, we painted it white. Whatever it is, or whatever color it is we like, green or light blue, or we painted a color that's acceptable. It's not uncommon in the church to hear somebody testify, "The Lord told me to do this," and I just said, "Nope, Lord, I'm not doing that." And we all chuckle. We should be broken and crying over something like that. And then I always wanted to tell the end of the story. Because if they tell the end of the story, when you start out over here a little bit off with God, and you go very far down that road, you find yourself a million miles away from God. Can you say amen?
Yeah.
And there's no such thing as a little rebellion. When God calls us unto himself, he desires fellowship. He desires us to commune with him. He wants us to walk with him. He wants us to talk with him. He wants to share his heart with us and us with him. He wants to speak to us about eternal things. Can you say amen? He doesn't expect that when we go to heaven, we're going to be going to a strange place or talking with a stranger. Can you say amen?
Yes.
You ever thought about, are you ready to go to heaven tonight? Have you ever thought about that? I didn't plan on speaking on this point, but I've been thinking about it recently. Are you ready to leave your loved ones behind and go to heaven, really? I mean, leave everybody that you know and love and spend time with and hang out with and laugh with and go to places with and all. Do we really love Jesus that much that we're ready to do that? And we maybe we should be asking ourselves this question. Maybe there's some sort of thing going on in our own hearts or our own lives that made us. I can remember back in the day when I was here under Pastor Buck's ministry, and a group of us went back then. Was it called Cleansing Stream, I think? Somebody help me remember.
Yeah.
Powerful teaching. You sat in a room for like 6 weeks of classes, two nights a week, and then you went away as a group to some place. We went to Pittsburgh, I remember, and there was a deliverance ministry that took place. Powerful, powerful ministry. But I never heard it taught any other place in the church, but it even taught during that time. It had you examine your heart to see if you worshiped your own children. That seems like a cold one. That seems like a low blow, like a hit beneath the belt, like God would be too hard. He's not too hard. He only understands this, that he wants you to love your children with all your heart and be the best mom and best dad you can be, grandpa, grandma you can be. He wants you to do that. He just doesn't want you to love them more than him.
Yes.
Can you say amen?
Yes.
And that's fair because he's God.
Yeah.
Can you say amen?
Yes.
He's the creator of the universe. He knows what he's doing. What does our Heavenly Father seek tonight? What does he seek? Does he seek? I think we'd all agree tonight to say that he seeks the Jesus type. That Jesus modeled what it was for us. Can you say amen?
Amen.
To be the perfect example of someone who pleased the Father. Is that too much of a stretch for us to accept that? Actually, there's a scripture on that, and I think I wrote it out here somewhere. There's many scriptures that talks about him being our example. Can you say amen? And that we know Christ died for us. We understand all the wonderful things the Lord did for us. But in Hebrews, it talks about the Lord being our example, Jesus being our example. Does anybody want to raise their hand tonight and share with us something that you think Jesus is a good example of in today's world that helps us to model? In other words, I could do this because Jesus did it and I know it's the right thing. Anyone? Real quick, be brief, please, and we'll move on. Yes?
How to deal with anger.
That's a good one. Very good, yes. Other kids? Tons of them, yes.
Forgiveness.
Forgiveness. It's awesome, yes.
Suffering.
Suffering, dealing with suffering, yes. He modeled all these things, see? He modeled it. Anyone else?
Servant leadership.
Servant leadership, yes.
Love your enemies.
Love your enemies. See, what Jesus really modeled for us, how many know that Jesus spent a lot of time in prayer? Say amen. He modeled for us as man, very man, that he couldn't do anything. Matter of fact, he did very little before the Spirit of God came upon him. Can you say amen? The Holy Spirit had to come upon him, and if he didn't do everything he did by the power of the Holy Spirit, then he didn't fulfill the man, very man side of being the perfect sacrifice. Can you say amen? He didn't do that because he was God. He did it because he was human. And as a human, he needed the fullness of the power of the Holy Spirit. And he didn't choose to pray. He had to pray. Can you say amen?
Amen.
He had to pray. He had to. He wanted to spend time with the Father. When he cried out on the cross, and I'm probably not saying it right, I say it this way, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. When he cried out from the cross, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Which, by the way, in Aramaic says, Father, I have finished the work that thou hast called me to do. And we'll talk about that one another time. But in Aramaic, that's what it's, how it's interpreted. But when he cried out, it was the first time as he bore the sins of the world that he'd ever been separated from his heavenly Father in all of eternity. Can you say amen? Because his heart was so broken. Jesus models for us. Can you say amen? That perfect walk with God. Well, here it is. For even hereunto were you called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow in his steps. I'm sorry, it's in 1 Peter 2:21, not Hebrews. That we should follow in his steps. In Hebrews 11:6, it says, he that comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. One of my favorite passages of scripture. He is a rewarder of them. Say this all together. He's a rewarder. God has rewards. He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Now, when the writers of the New Testament and the original Greek came across this scripture, they didn't know what to do. They didn't know what to put. You may find it other ways in other translations, but those two words are exactly the same word said twice. He is a rewarder of them that seek him. He is a rewarder of them that seek him. They put the word diligently in there because they didn't know what to put. He is a rewarder of them that seek him a lot. He's a rewarder of them, mathematicians. Seek squared. Can you say amen? Some of you will get that later. He's a rewarder of them. How many of you know tonight that people that pray a lot agree a lot? You've heard me say that before, probably. Why? Because in the presence of the Father, in the presence of Jehovah, as he is illuminating our minds with his Spirit and his presence and his ideas and his revelations and his thought, and he's teaching us about heavenly things, as we're walking with our brothers and sisters in the body of Christ, and they are seeking him and drawing into him, and he is filling their hearts and their minds with the knowledge of his will, and that's a big one. And we're all seeking him together but separately, and we're seeking him a lot. Our minds, we have access to the minds of Christ. Can you say amen? We have access to the thoughts and the counsels of God. Can you say praise God? Isn't it awesome? Have you ever sat down with a brother or sister, and they may even be at an airport or something, you find another Christian, start talking, all of a sudden it's like this common thing that goes on. All of a sudden, oh yeah, yeah, do you know God? Yeah, God showed me that too. It's like, how many can put your hands up? Has that happened? Maybe with a family member, maybe with whatever. It's an awesome thing. It's an awesome thing. It's an awesome thing when there's a prophecy on the floor, and it's exactly what the pastor's preaching on that day. Or Brother John, or one of the worship leaders, Sister Karen, one of them takes a song, and it ties in perfectly with what they're going to speak, what pastor's going to speak on that day. You say amen. Because God wants us to fellowship with Him, and in fellowshipping with Him in prayer and walking with Him in His presence, our minds become illuminated by a knowledge of His will, and we have the same heart and the same mind. Can you say amen? And it's a beautiful thing. And it, a few weeks ago, somebody helped me remember, I know our sister remembered his name, that spoke to us from work with the Native Americans, and he was here. Oh, what was his name? Maybe remember. Anyway, he's a Bible college teacher and works with the out west. He spoke about unity. And if we want the anointing, we should have unity. Can you say amen?
Amen.
I work at a college. And at the college, it's just brain against brain. I've been in multiple classes. I took several classes several years that I was there. It's just brain against brain. And they kind of celebrate that at colleges, brain against brain. But you want to try to get unity, just try to take a bunch of college professors and try to put them together and have them be in a committee planning something. Oh my goodness. It's not a pretty sight. You say amen. God bless them. Because it's brain against brain, right? There is no unity. And then sometimes it's flavor against flavor and style against style and culture against culture. And all the things, and they have exactly the same problems in those kind of places. It could be a hospital, it could be a big office complex, who knows what. But you've got a bunch of people coming together. It could be Corning Glass, those of you who work at Corning Glass. Wherever it is, you got a bunch of brains coming together and they're trying to plan something, and they gotta have committee meeting after committee meeting. Because the people can't agree. And then we try to do something in the church. And we have the same problem too often. You know why? If we're being honest, it's because we've not sought the Lord about that particular thing. And the people who have sought the Lord about it, who do have the mind of God, sometimes to us just become weird. Hello? I worked in youth ministry for 25 years. I know a little bit about this. Because I have God tell me, and as I've been in prayer, to lead me to do something or go somewhere, take on some activity, and then I had to bring it before the board, you know what I'm saying? Or I had to get someone else's permission. And there are times I actually had men of God just be honest with me, Nolan, I've not had time to pray about that yet. I just need some time to pray. Isn't that an awesome thing? Isn't that being honest? Can you say amen? I want to know tonight how many of you have actually prayed about Carmen coming to this church? Or how many of you started forming an opinion about it before you had a chance to really seek the Lord? I just thought I'd throw that out there just for fun. Because that's the truth. The bottom line is if our pastor felt God calling to do this, and we just need to rally behind him. Amen. That's it. My son Aaron's basketball team at Elmira Christian Center one time. And God gave me a message for the Christian basketball team. And the message was, there's no such thing as Christian basketball. Somebody would argue with me about that. And I went on to say, it's not a sin to win. Because basketball is just basketball. Can you say amen?
Yes.
And you play to win. Can you say amen? We're not out there to be, you know, nicey nice on the court. Steal that ball from that guy, man. Go down and score a point. You say amen.
Amen.
But I also took him that night and took the coach, and I had all the boys on the court. I said, I want you all to pick somewhere else in the room to just pick a spot and stare at it a minute. It doesn't matter where it is in the gym here, just pick something. I said, now all of you begin to walk towards that spot, whatever you looked at. Of course, they're going all over the place, all around me. I said, okay, now everybody back on the floor. I said, now, Coach Davis, I want you to stand over there. And Coach Davis, I want you to pick a spot. And I want you to start walking towards it. And boys, I just want you to follow everywhere Coach Davis goes. And they all got in a line. It was like this big, beautiful, it was like a snake, sorry. But anyway, they were all going in the same direction. Can you say amen? You know, when we get a hold of God, and if something is amiss, something is not right, someone has missed God, with whatever it is, How many of you know if you see a brother taken in a fall, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, unless thou likewise fallest into the same temptation? Can you say amen? Throw the grace at them that we all want from Jesus every day, not criticism. Can you say amen?
Yes.
But keep praying. Can you say amen? Keep seeking the Father. Those that pray a lot agree a lot is one of my favorite little sayings. And another one is there's always time for prayer for people who pray. I think it was Pastor Joe, maybe first year or something. It was, you know, all this stuff. I have a 60-year-old brain here, forgive me, but I don't remember how things always tie together and when they were, but I remember a prayer meeting we had in this church, and it was not long after Pastor Joe got here. I think it might have been the first year around that went into the New Year's. And I remember a Monday night coming here, and there was a concert of prayer that went on in this place that just rocked my world in a positive way. I heard people praying that I didn't even know they knew how to pray like that. And we went around this church and God came down and we closed off that evening that night. And I mean, God came down in our group and the presence of God was there. How many know God just wants to answer prayer? Can you say amen? God has chosen to limit his power to the prayers of men and women. Can you say amen? God wants to be where he's invited. Can you say amen? God wants to be where he's wanted. Can you say amen? We know how to pray, church. Can you say amen? All of us know how to pray. It's just we're not doing it. But we may do it over our breakfast or over our lunch or our night-night prayers. But we're Pentecostal. Can you say amen? Can I tell you that I longed for years to have a wife that prayed like some of the Pentecostal women prayed that I'd heard pray as I traveled as an evangelist? I longed for that. Because some of the women that are out there, and I've heard men pray that way, and we need to be praying more as men. Can you say amen?
Yes.
We need to be having that heart, that cry out. But when I met Edie, our first date, we went out for a dinner, and then we said, what are we going to do now? And she said, let's go to the church and pray. And I'd heard her pray before probably, but I want to tell you, heaven came down that night in a powerful way. And as I've said it before with you and the group, there's nothing more beautiful in my home or in the church than to hear Edie pray and cry out to God with her whole heart. Amen. You know, we need to cry out to God with our whole heart and say amen.
Amen.
And that's biblical. You know, we can say our little Baptist prayers, excuse me, if you want to. God is great, let us thank him for our food, amen. And I don't know how far that gets. I don't think it gets past the ceiling, but it's better to pray that way than not at all, I suppose. Can you say amen?
Amen.
But we know how to pray, church. Say amen. God is seeking for Central Assembly of God in Horsehead to start praying like we've never prayed before. Does anybody recognize how bad things are in this nation? Does anybody recognize how bad things are in the community? Does anybody, you know, that's when revival has happened in history. Under the preaching of Charles Finney in the 1800s, a lawyer who got saved praying under a stump down in the woods for 3.5 hours, God poured out his spirit to come out of there and eventually gave up his law practice and traveled preaching the word of God. 800,000 people came to Christ as he traveled on horseback and carriage from town to town with no microphones, no speakers, no worship team, not that bad, but nothing but him and the word of God. And he had a man joined him named Father Nash. Father Nash used to go in and get actually under the platform where he's preaching and lay on his face before God and intercede as Charles Finney was preaching up top. People, over 5,000 men came to Christ in a logging camp north of where they were preaching without a preacher or a gospel message even sent up there. And they sent down the revival, sent us a preacher up here that can teach us the word of God. I want to tell you, God is no respecter of persons. If he did it then, he can do it now. Can you say amen? It's in a time in history that we've got to, brothers and sisters, begin to call upon God like we've never called upon him before. It's time to make time to pray. It's time to set aside those things that entertain us, those things we think are cute, those things we think are fun, those things that just take up all of our time, and when we get done with it, we're just hungry again in a half an hour.
Yes.
Set aside some of those things and begin to call upon God. Can you say amen?
Yes.
I know you watched War Room recently, and Edie and I have bought that movie. We watched it at our house. How many seen the movie War Room?
Yeah.
It's time to begin to pray like we've never prayed before. Can you say amen?
Amen.
He's seeking. He's seeking. He's seeking for a people who will worship him in spirit and in truth. He wants to have a garden experience with you. Can you say amen?
Amen.
He wants to have it every day, not during a woman's conference or a men's retreat. Can you say amen? Yes, those things are powerful, but they can. It's like one guy said, do you need to pray for the Holy Ghost every day to fill you? Why is that? He said, I leak. We leak. Can you say amen? Yesterday's experience won't get us through today. We must begin to call upon our Maker, upon our God, upon our Creator. And you know what? When we begin to do that, people are going to see it in us. Can you say praise God tonight? People are going to see it in our hearts and in our lives. You know, we fight revival the way a sinner fights God to come into their hearts to begin with. We as believers fight revival the way a sinner fights God to come into their hearts to begin with. Some of us get to a certain place of growth in our life spiritually, and God begins to deal with us about an area right there. And that sweet rebellion comes in where we say, no, not that, Lord. I'm not willing to give that up yet. And that yet that you camp out on, you can be camping on that for years. And you can find yourself an old man or an old woman and have never gotten past that yet. And as soon as you begin to hit your knees at an altar and ask God to revive your soul, that's the first thing he's going to take you to. He's going to take you back all those years where you refused to forgive that one, or you refused to love this one, or you refused to go here, or you refused to do the ministry he called you to do. He's going to take you right back there because he can, because he's God. Can you say amen?
Amen?
And he knows what the best thing for our lives are. Oh, if we could just get that church. If we could just understand that the Creator of the universe knows what's best for our lives. Can you say amen?
Amen.
He knows what's best. But we wrestle against revival. If we could somehow do a survey of the amount of people in this church, or any church, who are to be honest and say, I really don't want revival. I kind of like church the way it is. I kind of like my life the way it is. I kind of like going here and doing this and doing that and spending time with this person and that person. And I don't want anything to upset that. Sometimes I don't even come on Wednesday nights. I certainly don't want a revival to hit where there's church 6 or 7 nights a week. I'm sorry, Brother Nolan, if I were to be honest, I don't want that. God's got a word for you, selfish, selfish, selfish man or woman. Because the souls that will come into the kingdom and be saved. You know how many people are laying in bed tonight in Horsehead or in Elmira and they will go to sleep alone. And when they wake up in the middle of the night, they'll wake up alone. And when they go to the doctors, they'll go to the doctor alone. They don't know Jesus. You know him. He's there with you through every situation in life. Why are we so selfish tonight that we would want our lives rather than want someone or multiple someones to find what we take for granted every day in a beautiful relationship with our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ?
Amen.
They don't know what it is to have a Heavenly Father. They'd love to be able to forgive, but they can't. There's no basis for forgiveness in their life. The gospel holds the answers for drug addicts to become free, alcoholics to be made sober, marriages to be healed, little children to find a mommy or daddy again. I want to tell you, this just goes on, and we know it, we've lived it. Can you say amen? If we took all of our testimonies tonight and put them together of all the things that Christ has done for us. And yet we're so selfish as to say, I want my life the way it is. God, forgive us. God, forgive us. I one time went to a church in Ogdensburg, New York. Brother John was there one time when I was preaching there. I used to like to camp in the Thousand Islands off Goose Bay at Great Point State Park. And I got to know a pastor in that region. Whenever I went north, he'd have me come up and preach. And it was a great joy. He recently went to be with the Lord, the pastor there. But in Ogdensburg, the Assemblies of God Church there, good, just wonderful time. I remember praying all day about what to speak that night, and I came in with a scripture. And the scripture was, therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. And the title of that message that night was The Worst Sin in the Bible. And a mother and son came forward at the end, and we had a powerful prayer time. Because she said, this morning as we were having coffee, the Spirit of God spoke that same word into our own hearts. To him that knows to do good and does it not, to him it is sin.
Right.
We know how to do it. We know we should do it. Because we've heard so many teachings on a false, end-time, demonic-based love, we think we don't have to do it. I say demonic-based love because it's born in the pits of hell that lulls us to sleep with lovey-dovey songs and love this and love that. And it's not love when we can live in selfishness and ignore the needs of the people around us, and our country and our world is going to hell in a handbasket, and we can't even show up for a prayer meeting. The message years ago called If. Edie and I really didn't know each other much back then, but she remembers, she shares with me a message I preached on If. God's love has conditions. I hate to wake you up tonight, but every promise in the Bible says if.
Amen.
If you, then I will. If you, then I will. If you, then I will. If my people, 2 Chronicles 7:14, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and heal their land.
Amen.
Is there ever a time we needed this? Can you say amen?
Amen.
Is there ever a time and the Holy Spirit is just weeping over us.
Yes.
Those of you that are in here Sunday morning and heard something very prophetic and may have not known what was going on, the Holy Spirit was weeping over us. The Spirit of God is grieved and envious of our desires often. He was weeping over us. As we need to be weeping over souls and weeping over our communities and weeping over the fact that we just kind of wipe our mouths and say we have done no evil. We kind of blow off God like he's this buddy that we now have, and that it's okay that we don't follow his word. It's okay that we're not seeking his face. It's just okay because when we die we're going to go to heaven and. God help us all to say amen.
Amen.
I've been asking God to increase my prayer time. We all need an increased time. It starts out as a discipline. There are times you won't feel like praying. Edie and I will come in here on Friday nights and pray together. We've been doing it since we first met. And one night, I remember not that long ago, I said at first, I don't feel like praying tonight. Just nothing in me wanted to pray. I felt like garbage in my physical body. I just felt yucky. Felt tired. We didn't take, maybe halfway around, and all of a sudden the Spirit of God fell on us. And there was so much peace, we didn't even want to pray, as the presence of God just engulfed us as we walked round and round and round this church. And God, you never know what God is going to do if you'll just, no matter how you feel, no matter what you want, no matter what your flesh is saying, if you'll just go to that garden place where it can just be you and the Lord, and you'll do it every day. He is a rewarder. Can you say amen tonight? Of those that diligently seek him. I guarantee you'll make people jealous. People will be jealous of what God does in your life. And they'll go, why is God doing this and that for him or for her? He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. That's it. He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. He also likes those that delight themselves in him. Can you say amen?
Amen.
We delight ourselves in him him, he grants us the desires of our heart. Delight ourselves in him. You see, it's going back to that garden. It's going back to that place of the Spirit. It really is prioritizing the spiritual realm. It really is prioritizing the things of the kingdom. Because we are three part. We're a spirit, soul, and body. We're a mind, we're a body, and we're a spirit. And we spend much of our time on our mind and body, entertaining our mind, doing things for our body. We spend much of our time doing that. And the time that we spend on our spirit is greatly limited. Because we limit it. The Lord is seeking. I just got to close tonight, the last few minutes, with some thoughts on revival. That I've studied revival all my life. For all my adult life in the Lord. This is so fascinating to me. Sometimes, if you've seen something called the Transformations video, look it up online. I showed it in one of my Sunday school classes, where in countries all over the world, God is now, last time I heard, down in Williamsburg or Williamstown, something like that, West Virginia, a revival just hit, and it went, the church began to fill up, and they didn't have room anymore in the church, so they went to another building, a large public building, and the last I heard, they're meeting in the large coliseum in the town, because there's so many people coming to Christ and coming to God. God's pouring out His Spirit there. But every single revival, including Brownsville, including any that we, Toronto, that we might name, where God might maybe moved in different ways, maybe some of those we didn't understand. And any revival, it always started with prayer intercession. It always started with a group of people praying, then a few more, then a few more, then a few more. Many times as a youth group in the country of Wales in 1800, the entire country got saved, so that they could not find one single unsaved person in the whole country. Crime went to zero. The police had nothing to do. The police started traveling around in churches singing in quartets. Because they had nothing to do, there was zero crime in the entire country. It started with two brothers that got on their knees and began to pray. They begin to move the spirit realm into the natural. They begin to walk once again in the garden with the Father. They begin to delight in that. Why revival tarries? Why can't I think of the author of that book, Edie? Can you remember? Why revival tarries, John? You know, okay, it'll come to me later, but we looked him up because we, Edie and I every morning have a devotional time and we read the Bible, but we'll also read through a book. And we're Leonard Ravenhill, now of the Lord. But Leonard Ravenhill, we decided to look him up, Google him, and find out a little bit about him because he taught Paul so much about prayer and spending time with the Father. We wondered the last years of his life, what he did. And there's someone on there, if there's his son or his some relative, said that before he died, it was not uncommon for him to spend 10 hours a day in prayer. I've never heard of anybody pray that much. Apostle Paul said he prayed without ceasing. Can you say amen? Maybe he was retired and just had that kind of, it doesn't matter. There's no magic number. For you, praying 15 minutes might be a lot. Can you say amen? And it might be a lot in God's eyes because maybe for me, I only pray X amount of time and X plus is always good in God. Can you say amen? Because now we begin to hear his voice. We begin to know his mind. We begin to know his heart. You know what is a body? All this squabbling and quarreling and things that sometimes go on between brothers and sisters just stops. It just stops. There's no way you're going to pray for somebody and turn around and criticize them. And if you've been criticizing them, you won't be able to pray for them. You know why? Because you're sinning. And if you got sin in your life or hidden sin in your life, and I've been there where God had to deal with me about something, and my prayers were just bouncing off the ceiling. But prayer will always change us from the inside out. Can you say amen? Yeah. The Heavenly Father tonight seeks. He seeks for a people who will worship Him. Let's bow our heads and close in prayer. He seeks for a people who will worship Him in spirit and in truth. He's looking for a people who will prioritize the spiritual realm in their life. Well, maybe turn off the TV for a while. Get on their knees or begin to walk in prayer. Go for a walk in their community. silent in prayer, or come over to the church and begin to cry upon the Lord with their whole hearts until the glory of God comes down. I saw a vision here about a year ago, and it was on a vision of a Wednesday night, and on a Wednesday night, these altars were filled with people praying.
Yes.
On a Wednesday night.